Okay, our next presenter is Jim Cochran, who pretends that he's retired as the Gunnison County Wildlife Coordinator, but he's still going strong, so.
Good morning.
I'm Jim Cochran.
Started out retired, semi-retired, didn't work, so I'm back. I don't know. Anyway, welcome to Gunnison County. It wasn't below zero this morning, so bring them up here. My talk basically is about Gunnison County's Sage-Grouse Conservation Program. You're going to hear a lot today about collaborative conservation. We add locally based collaborative conservation to that. We believe that beginning with the local conservation community, the local landowners, local government, we can be more effective and achieve what we really need to do. As Pat said, collaborative conservation isn't easy, but it does work. So real quickly, I'll run through these. Everybody's seen this slide ad infinitum. Gunnison-based population is the largest of seven populations, both in sage-grouse numbers and in land area. The Gunnison-based population comprised of two counties, Gunnison and Sawatch County. Our regulations and the discussion today about Gunnison County's program, we limited our consideration of where we should attempt to begin to occupy habitat. Gunnison County has about 430,000 acres of occupied habitat. Sawatch County has about 160,000 acres. That doesn't mean within that polygon that it's all habitat. It means that there are patches of non-habitat, the Mesa Reservoir, City of Gunnison, patches of timber and so on. But this is where we started. So, and this, hopefully these numbers somewhat match Kathy Griffin's, but it doesn't really matter. Basically, you can see that the Gunnison Basin by orders of magnitude is the largest numerically population of Gunnison sage-grouse. We have somewhere between 80 and 90% of all Gunnison sage-grouse in the basin. Roughly 80% of those reside in Gunnison County, about 20% in our neighbors, Sawatch County. So, though Gunnison County has been involved with sage-grouse since at least 1995, when the local work group was formed, really in 2005, after extensive discussions in 2003 and 2004, Gunnison County decided to up the ante as far as their sage grouse program. We had attended local work group meetings. We actually had conducted several conservation projects on our property on the W Mountain Ranch south of Gunnison. But really in 2005, with a proposed listing on the horizon and with guidance provided by a new range-wide conservation plan, the Gunnison County Board of County Commissioners adopted both a sage-grouse action plan, formed the Gunnison Basin Sage-Grouse Strategic Committee, and created a sage-grouse conservation program, something that, to our knowledge, no other county in the United States has. They actually, with the guidance from this action plan, created the strategic committee, which now has 13 regular members. It also has 13 alternates, so it gets a little cumbersome, but nevertheless, this is a little bit different beast from what we had as a local work group, but most people have as working groups. This is a formal entity of Gunnison County. It has the goal of consensus, but it is a majority rule committee. And it has met monthly with very few exceptions since 2005. Includes all of the agencies, Gunnison County Stockbrokers, High Country Conservation Advocates, representatives of both Gunnison County and Swatch County, and importantly, the public at large, development community, and recreation community. All the members are formally appointed by the Gunnison County Board of County Commissioners, except for the Swatch County representative, who's appointed by their Board of County Commissioners. The Sage-Grouse Conservation Program, the board decided, one, they needed professional staff. The program, we do land use permit reviews. We provide administrative support for the strategic committee. Obviously, we're a resource for our Board of County Commissioners, resource for the Planning Commission, County Attorney. We interface with federal and state agencies. We review other local government action for Gunnison Sage-Grouse impact. And we have been the county representative basically for lots of other sage-grouse conservation activities, including the climate change working group, rearing habitat resiliency projects, NRCS state technical committee, and we worked with landowners on the Kennedy conservation agreement with assurance certificate of inclusion, Quinas, providing a resource for those landowners. Now, in 2006, Gunnison County took the unprecedented step of adopting sage-grouse specific land use regulations. If there was an easy way to fill the boardroom, that was it. Every time we had a public meeting, a hearing, or a work session, landowners were understandably very concerned. So the board did it in two steps. In 2006, they adopted standalone land use regulations specific to Gunnison Sage-Grouse that sunsetted in 1 year. That was to allow the public to see the regulations and see how they would be implemented and allow us to work toward permanent regulations amending our land use code. We used a disturbance guidelines from the Gunnison Sage-Grouse Range Conservation Plan, and after 1 year, we adopted permanent regulations, amended the land use code for Gunnison County, and have worked under those. We worked under those regulations until 2013, after the development of a habitat prioritization tool, basically mapping habitat in the Gunnison Basin. Those regulations were amended to allow us more precisely implement them on the ground. The habitat prioritization tool, which is a key to where we are now with our regulations, was developed by the Strategic Committee's Technical Subcommittee in 2012. It provides numeric prioritization of all Gunnison Sage-Grouse habitat types. Basically, I can score the habitat. It scores a range from a low of minus 30 some to a high of plus 48. It's useful as a starting point in implementing our regulations and working with landowners, trying to, and working with people as they wish to develop their land or to do projects, whatever, on their land. So it works across all land ownership. It's soils based. The technology is exportable to other populations, and I know Mindy Rice is here, she loves validation. We have some validation against CPW radio caller data in March 2013. Basically, what it said was that about 80% of those radio caller locations, just raw locations, were found in what we have identified as tier one habitat. In other words, the most important habitat in the basin. And about 16% was in positive scoring habitat that wasn't tier one habitat. So we felt pretty good about that because the tool didn't use sage-grouse locations as its basis. It simply was based on soils, and it measures potential. It says, based upon the soil, slope, aspect, this is what you should see when you're out there. So, knowing that the bird used it, that was kind of nice. Tier one habitat is basically those habitats that the overall habitat score, so all habitats combined, score 15 or greater in the tool. And when we map that, that works out to almost 60% of all of the occupied habitat in the basin is tier one habitat. Obviously, that's habitat that we would like to conserve, that we would like to manage, and much of that's across public and private lands. So, how do we deal with that? Our current land use regulations are based. One, upon the disturbance guidelines and the range wide conservation plan. In the tier one habitat, which covers the permits counties issue, basically building permits, septic permits, ISDS permits, driveway permits, access permits, subdivision approvals. Tier one habitat, we emphasize that. And we work through that process with Colorado Parks and Wildlife. Tier two habitat, we don't discount it, but if we have to say that is for development, we would prefer it to go, it's in tier two habitat. It can turn into a complicated process if you're a landowner. If you do something in tier one habitat, how do we deal with that? But it does give us good guidance. Without the habitat prioritization tool, it was a very difficult process. So, Gunnison County right now, everything that occurs on private lands, and actually sometimes to the dismay of public lands in Gunnison County, we actually regulate surface disturbing activities on public and private lands, in addition to what the public land managers may do, but it's the list of the activities that counties can regulate, and Gunnison County does. So subdivisions, land use changes, ag to commercial is an example, building permits, ISDS permits, access permits, in other words, driveways and roads. Minor and major impact projects, which may be significant changes to the landscape. And most importantly, we developed under these regulations a pre-application conference. A landowner who wants to do something, build a house, build a road, or a landowner who doesn't know what they want to do, but simply wants an assessment of sage-grouse values, habitat values on their land, can come to the county. It's called a pre-application conference. That gives us an opportunity to go out and work with the landowner before that landowner becomes vested in what they want to do. We can help guide them through that. It's a very effective process. We've used it numerous times. So that is a difference, I think, from most land use codes who don't offer that at all. So we condition permits to a avoid, minimize, or mitigate, and so, real quickly, we can change the things. What can we do? Counties can address the natural factors, predation, genetic risk, drought, most of the non-surface disturbing uses on public lands, but we can address some things. Development on public and private lands, road, power lines, we are able to try to address inadequate regulatory mechanisms at the local level, and most importantly, we can bring people together and work with landowners on conservation easements and other collaborative conservation efforts. The result, public, private lands, conservation easements, properties enrolled in the candidate conservation agreement, approximately 80% of the priority habitat, in other words, tier one habitat in the Gunnison Basin, within the occupied habitat polygon is protected.
Tier 1 and Tier 2 land modification. Is there any thing in the land use plan that allows you to do land swapping or exchanges or value, or is it all based on a Tier 2 landscape that was originally proposed on a Tier 1 landscape?
Can we repeat the question?
The question is, with Tier 1 and Tier 2 habitat, have there been land swaps, or is there the opportunity for land swaps? There is. We haven't done that right now. Obviously, even though we've been using it for quite some time, that the concept's relative limited. But there is that opportunity out there. And if we can figure out how to do it, then yeah. Pardon?
Clearly, I applaud Gunnison County for all that they've done in collaborating with the Strategic Planning Committee towards the goal of conservation. To my understanding, the county is still looking to battle the listing decision in court. Now that we've been beyond the listing and lived with it for a little while, do you see major impacts coming to the county as a result of listing? And do you think that continuing to battle the listing decision remains a productive path for us to count?
Question is basically battling the litigation, challenging the listing. From my perspective, certainly it's a distraction. It takes time. From our perspective, and from the state's perspective, it's a worthwhile argument that what we're doing is more effective than what the listing will accomplish. So, as a biologist, I'll argue that the best situation would be no listing with continued collaborative conservation among all of us. That's my argument. How do we get there? Unfortunately, that brings us to the courts dealing with that. And unfortunately, I mean, I've learned more about litigation in the last year than I care to, but it's an essential part of our society. So Gunnison County is going to continue to challenge the listing, but at the same time, we're not backing away from conservation, and we're not backing away from working with Fish and Wildlife Service and other entities that are involved in that process. That's the best I can give you. It is definitely a distraction.